something different today, a different type of video rather than the ordinary vlogs. I did the Le Service course Mount Me ride, or part of it anyway, today, and there was a bit of a hit out and a race up me. Whenever there's a long climb and a big group of riders, there's going to be a hit out up it. So there's a mixed abilities within the group. So at the start, I was looking for who was going to sort of set the pace early and where could I get a good sit, because we ended up doing 16 minutes about 16 minutes for the me climb, the front group, and I needed to find a good spot to sit on, because it's not a steep climb, and if you want to set a good time, you definitely need to be sitting on at some point, because it's a 20k an hour sort of climb rather than Kutha back. It doesn't matter as much from a drafting perspective. So just sitting on early with the this looks like Harcourt's racing team, and look at it, cadence is good, sock coordination game is good. So happy to sit on here and just look to see who's going to make the first move. I mean, we haven't really come onto the climb proper yet. This is the first little ramp before it, and just sort of testing out who's going to set the pace. But I knew this guy ahead of us was pretty strong, and if he attacked off the front, he probably could gap everyone. So I did a little watt spike, probably a mistake. I probably could have ended up just sitting on the Harcourt's guys for a fair while anyway, because doing 340 watts, 350 watts this early before the climb's even started, probably not a great idea, bridging over here, because they were already hooking on the front. But wasn't too bad, because you can see single file, it's the pace was on early before the climb had even started. So definitely it wasn't a race or anything. It was just a friendly post-Christmas group ride, but it's great to be able to test your abilities. So slotting in here, had a really nice little position here, shielded from the wind by both the raised banks on the left and the dual file group of riders, and just sort of happy to wait. And you see how low my wattage is now, 150, 160, and free, an easy free wheel to start the climb with, rather than having to actually set the pace myself. So you don't want to be starting the climb, starting a 17 minute effort at maximum heart rate. So definitely having a power meter, the importance of sitting on, even with because we're going 30k an hour here, so freewheeling, so a draft actually matters. With a power meter, you see the importance of getting into a good position where you get the most draft, even when climbing. So on the left-hand side of the road, when there's a big banking on the side, and when it's dual file, you get loads of protection, versus the guy on my right, he's probably getting a little bit of wind on him, but doesn't matter because he's really strong. So look, this is where the climb first starts, and the guy on the front spikes it, so it's 400 watts to start, and you just know with, even though, you got a power meter, you can't be like, look guys, I need you to slow down, you're going over my threshold, and I'd like this interval to be really smooth pacing. Like, you're going to go quicker if you stay with the group, even if it means spiking your power. So doing 400 watts to start, I'm only 60 kilos, so these big guys, they'd be doing 500, 500 or so right now plus. It's not great for the heart rate, and it fills the legs with lactate straight away. And when you have a power meter, when you're training alone, to actually hit the highest power, if you're not going to draft, and to go the fastest, you want to be keeping this a lot smooth. So I averaged 284 watts for this climb with a lot of sitting on. So you want to keep it smooth versus the herky-jerky when it goes, 5% going 200 watts and then 7% going 380 watts. Doesn't do your heart rate or legs any favours. You see, the cadence is pretty good, pretty relaxed. So I always sort of look at who's got the most relaxed upper body. If someone's doing 350 watts, real smooth pedaling, no upper body movement, looking around, as you can see the guy on the left is with the blue kit on the back. If you were just having a gander, then you're probably a pretty strong rider. And then it levels off here, and see the guy on the front. I could tell, like, if you're doing 60 cadence, 55 cadence, then you're not really going to last for a 15 to 20 minute climb. You need to be doing a higher cadence than that. It's 2016, all the strongest dudes are climbing with a good smooth cadence. That's the way you get the most out of your fitness level. So just let this guy close the gap for me for the two guys that have started drilling in on the front. But then I was like, I think he was going backwards. So it's about quickly closing those gaps rather than if I'd sat on and while he was going backwards, then it's a 30 meter gap I would have closed, because when people are drilling on the front and someone pops, the gap opens up so fast. And so you see here, look at the difference in cadence between left and right. Look how smooth, powerful the guy is on the right, reducing those, the fatigue metabolites in your legs. And on the left, I don't know, he's in the big chain ring for some reason. And that's a surefire way to make your legs go zub-zub, especially on a long climb, which isn't that steep. Just good spinners. Spinning is the way to go. So it's doing... Where the power meter really helped me with this climb was, like, I was doing 300 watts sort of average, flicking between 270 up to 330, depending on the gradient. So less when it was 4% and more when it was 7%. But I was doing basically my threshold on the wheel, and I was at my max sort of threshold heart rate. I was at 189, 191 heart rate on the wheel. So knowing that, seeing my power, seeing that my power is really high on the wheel, given that I'm 60 kilos, so it was like, flicking between 5 watts a kilo. If I went on the front, I would just blow up, given the pace that's being set. If I went on the front and then tried to maintain this pace that this dude's doing, like, he's doing probably 400 watts right now, and and I'm doing 300, and he's probably doing more than 400 watts because he's heavier than me. And I just blow up trying to maintain 21k an hour up 5%. Like, I can't really drill that. I'm not fit enough. And you see, like, which dude do you think's going to last longer up this climb? So I just do my best to sit on this guy as long as I could. And then had a quick look at that view. Didn't have time to take the camera out. Sorry, gone too quick. Coming up here in a couple of days, though, at a more leisurely pace, and I can properly vlog the Mount Me climb. Such a nice climb. But yeah, I was probably a bit far up this early on. This is sort of 4 minutes into the climb proper, maybe. I'm second wheel, and it's a pretty good position to be in, but it means I'm going to get asked to take a turn pretty shortly, which, I don't really want to do, and B, I don't think I physically can do or do one that hard. So there would have been maybe a better draft back with the Harcourt's guys. There's probably 10 guys in the group left right now, and that'll dwindle down to 5. And then, I probably could have got a better draft if I'd sat behind a bit. So went up a little bit too early. And when you're second wheel, you really have to respond to the accelerations sort of immediately as the guy in the front. So he's going a bit easy now, 4%. And then as it goes up to 5-6, the watt spike, and you really have to respond to that to sit, get a perfect sit right on the wheel. Otherwise, up a climb, you're not going to get much benefit at all. So yeah, just sitting around 270, and I was like, and I knew I'd be very lucky to stay in this front group for this whole climb, and I'd have to sort of do everything right, all the tricks to actually stay in this group. So he knocked the power off a little bit, and I came through for my turn. And I knew I wasn't going to blow myself up. That's Ocean View Road on the right, by the way. Nice steep detour to the climb if you'd ever want to do that. But yeah, I didn't want to blow myself up. I knew if I tried to rip a 350-watt average turn for like a minute and a half, it was going to be night-night for my legs, and I'd end up having to turn around mid-climb and go down to the Debra Bakery and have 10 coffees. So just tried to keep it steady and firm, but not so fast, and sort of fast enough that I knew if there are people fitter than this, then, that think this is too easy, then they probably should be on the front driving it because they're a lot fitter than me. And this guy wasn't too happy with my pace, so he came around me and I was sort of, I probably should have gone back a few wheels, but I don't know, I didn't actually, I hadn't looked behind me, I didn't know how many people were behind me, and if I'd seen eight dudes sort of looking pretty fresh, I would have probably gone back. But look at this view, Lord of the Rings, great climb, the hairpins, great descent as well, perfect day for it, for the climb, bit of a tailwind I think as well. And if you want to know the difference between a handy cyclist and a professional cyclist, you're about to see it on your right. We are in a train, drilling it, doing our best. Everyone is on the limit. There's no talking, single file. And doing what I think is pretty good watts. And there's the under 23 National Road Championship champion from a few years ago going past us, just about mouth closed, chatting to us on the way past. Doing it easy out of the saddle. So, and there's got to be something wrong with my brain, because when he came past, I almost thought it'd be a good idea for me to do a 700 watt effort to try and get on his wheel, which would have been the worst idea in the world ever, because I would have gotten popped within 30 seconds. So yeah, that's the difference between being a handy rider and, you know, an alright climber, and you know, the top 0.0001%, you know, he's a pro rider for Drapac. He's racing the Tour of Utah and, like, tears up track. So, I got more chance, you know, we got more chance of being in the NBA, all I do as a 5'7" guy that can't jump, than being a professional road cyclist at 23. And if you don't have the training in the legs, by then, it's too late. So then Mauro came round. I was, when that other dude pulled off, I was like, I'm not pulling another turn. I'm already pretty binned. So Mauro came round and just destroyed everyone and just whittled this down to about five dudes, including me. I mean, a little bit of upper body movement, and but really smooth pedal strokes. It looks like he just gets great power efficiency into the pedals. And he's a tall guy, maybe 6 foot, 6'1", I think, and but pretty lean, and just this sort of climb really suits a guy of that build, because it's about 5%, and if you have good absolute power, but also pretty good power to weight, you can really rip it up at about 20, 21k an hour, which he did. So he's from Milan as well, by the way. So when it went to 6, 7%, I was having to do 380 spikes to hold the wheel, and that's where, when you ride on the wheel in a climb, I think it's a little bit harder than being maybe sixth wheel in a bunch of 10. But luckily when it levels off, you get a bit of respite. And it really opens up here in the me climb. Like, I had really no idea how long was left. So I just knew that if I was on the limit and all I could do was sit on. And you see my cadence was 105 right now, 103, because it's not as steep. I prefer to stay in the same gear on a climb if it's not changing gradient too much, you know, just 1 or 2% up and down. I stay in the same gear and I'll just vary my cadence from 90 to 105 as needed. So obviously when you need to drop the power, increase the power, like now, or if it's not as steep, 105 cadence, and then if the power's gone down or whatever, 90 cadence. That's a good range for me and probably for most people, because when you change gear, even if you do it really efficiently, there's going to be a loss of power somehow, even if it's for a microsecond. So to really keep a steady high power output without dips in it, and then a corresponding spike as you get over the gear, it's good to stay in the same gear if you can, if the gradient's not changing too much. So yeah, not much really to see here, because Mauro just rips a monster turn, and I was just, at this point I was like, I'm going to stare at your brake caliper and try and shut my mind off, because there gets to a point in like a 15 to 20 minute climb in a group like this where you're hammering, where you just, because the pace is being set by someone else, you got no control over your pedaling or whatever, and all you can do is just stare at the wheel and just try and bin yourself. And just try and get deep, go deep, and think about how bad it would be. What I think about is how bad this would be if I was not on his wheel. If I drop off, it's going to take me longer to get to the top, and I'll go a lot slower. So You see he's gapping me a little bit, like I'm having to do little spikes to get back on, like when he's obviously feeling fresh and he's gapping me, and I'm pretty much coming to my limit here. And if I was on my own, it would be night-night. But you see, the power isn't as high overall on the wheel as it was at the start. But it's all the, even though my power was 283 for the 16 minutes, which I find pretty not that hard. Like, I can do that on a crit track on my own without, you know, if I was fresh, without too much difficulty. But because of the 340 watt spikes, it just really cooked me. So I was feeling binned, and I've let the other guys close the gap, and I'm trying to sit on the end of this group and try and make it as long as I can to the top. See, the cadence within this group is all very quick, very smooth. It's all over 90 for these guys, for the last five people. And we got a time Pinarello and a Cipollini. So I was in esteemed company on my secondhand Giant TCR. But yeah, this sort of proof, it doesn't matter what bike you're riding, what bike you have, it's pretty much your fitness. But we are hooking along now, we're going 30k an hour up this, this pretty much a flat bit of the climb, false flat, and had a bit of rest. But even with the rest, I couldn't get my heart rate down, so I knew it was going to be game over for me if there was any real surges. But here's the problem with being last wheel versus second wheel is, if this guy in front of me, he's going to leave a gap soon, and when he leaves a gap, you have to close 20 meters versus 1 meter to close the wheel, and that's too much when you're already binned. So being third wheel's not too bad, you can nip around, but yeah, when I'm doing 300 watts on his wheel, if he leaves a gap for me to get back onto the next riders, if they gap him by a fair bit, you have to drop like 420 watts, and that sort of proves how hard it is to close gaps, even if you're feeling okay. So right now, see, you lose the wheel, and it's going to be split up a little bit here, and I'm just hoping and just pedaling my heart out. So yeah, the pace, these guys definitely ramped, they were feeling fresh, so here's the gap, and I'm trying to close it. I can't even remember if I closed it or not. I don't know, this only happened this morning, but I'll do my best to try and spike it up and close it, but see how far it is and how quickly that gap opens up. And especially if those guys had stayed in a trio, I make it to this wheel, but I can't make it to the next wheel. So when you bend at the end of a long climb, every meter matters, a meter matters. But on this steep bit, ooh, that bike, it was just too far for me to close. And Mauro, I think, was pretty tired, though. He pulled that whole turn for like 5 minutes. I don't think the Harcourt guys didn't. So they were fresh. They got to sit on the whole ride. And when you do get that full sit, you're going to be fresher than dudes who pull turns. I mean, I'm not saying like they don't have to pull a turn. It's not a race or anything. It doesn't matter. Like, I'm just saying, for example, if you haven't pulled a turn at all, you are going to be fresher than guys who are fit, even if guys that are fitter than you, just by virtue of the fact you've had a draft, especially on a speed climb like this, and you're going to have fresh legs if you've kept good cadence for the end of it, which I think is coming up pretty shortly. This is why all these, it looks like it's the end of the climb, and I just didn't know, I didn't know when it was going to end, but I don't think Mauro did either, and he's trying to close this gap, so I just put myself on 270, tried to do 250, 270 watts and hold that because it was all over. But like the importance of drafting even on a speed climb on a climb like me, because you're going 20k an hour, that's the way to do the quickest time, is to sit on for as long as possible and then maybe in the last K, last minute, go full gas to the end, if the pace isn't high enough. So, crawling my way to the end of this climb, I'm really going to concentrate now. You know, I was lighter than all these guys on a climb, and I do a fair few Ks, and I wasn't able to keep up with the first three riders, which was a little bit disappointing for me. So now I'm doing just finished base build. I'm definitely going to focus on lots and lots and lots of wouldn't mind if he just pulled a turn to help me bridge that gap rather than attacking me. But anyway, I'm going to do lots and lots of 15-minute, 20-minute sort of threshold intervals, which I haven't really done, and really show, because in the last 3 minutes of that climb, you can see I just went night-night. But great climb, Mount Me, you know, very safe. You know, if you want to race for free and do something that's safe, climbing up a long climb like that's the way to do it. That was, you know, great fun, bit painful, but I think everyone enjoyed it. You can see everyone stopped for a rest because we were all pretty binned. See if I can get that pan out for that view. But thanks for watching. Cheers for the guys for the massive lead out. Cheers for Mauro, and look at that blue Cipollini. Whew. That is a fire bike, and made me feel a little bit self-conscious about the TCR. All right, stay tuned for the next vlog. Cheers for watching. Bye.